FISEC. My name is Alan Hone. I am the Director of Software Strategy, part of Lockheed Martin Corporate Engineering. And we are going to talk about what we have been doing together, along with GitLab, in order to secure our software supply chain, some of the activities with attestations and other areas. I wanted to lead off a little bit, just talking about how we got here. So a lot of governments across the world have been pushing on companies to secure software supply chains within the U.S. In 2021, there was an executive order, 1428, and it really, you know, laid out a set of best practices to say, look, like, it is critically important that we understand what goes into the software that we're building. You know, there's been obviously a bunch of main, you know, news headline examples of things like Log4j and SolarWinds, and like we want to put a stop to these kinds of things. And one of the key ways we can do that is by making sure we know what's in our software, how it's built, all those kinds of things. So we've been working together with Linux Foundation, CNCF, OpenSSF, companies like TestifySec, who are really doing great things in this space, exploring what can be done in order to solve this challenge. And really, we bring it around three things: provenance, pedigree, and integrity. So by provenance, we mean, like, how did we get to where we are with the piece of software? Where did it come from? Who contributed to it? How was it built? And can we have metadata that actually rides with the software, so that when you have the software in hand, you also have that information about where it came from? By pedigree, we mean, like, what goes into, we know that every system that we deliver to our customers has thousands of pieces of software in it. What are all those pieces of software, usually represented in a software bill of materials? And then tying those two concepts together is integrity. How can we be sure that only authorized contributors put in commits into the repository? How can we be sure that the build environment wasn't tampered with, that the right steps were followed? What were all those steps? And collecting all that together with signatures, and then, as you'll see, Cole demonstrate with a transparency ledger. So our goal with our software supply chain security is, you know, we're going to make it easy for our programs to generate software bills and materials. We have a common set of GitLab pipeline modules that enable that. Programs can use and tailor those pipelines, and built right in there are, you know, all the things you'd expect in terms of testing and static analysis and other security steps. But then, of course, critically, they also generate the software bill of materials. What were all the third-party dependencies that went into this particular component? And then, you know, as we assemble the software, assembling all those SBOMs up. As we do that, we also provide provenance for some of the open source software that comes into Lockheed Martin, because, you know, we, in the future, we'd love to get to a place where open source programs are generating that provenance data themselves, and they're embedding it. Today, we're not quite there yet, and so what we do is, right at the moment that open source software comes into Lockheed Martin, we generate that provenance information, we sign it, and we store it using TestifySec's Archivista tool. And then as teams build and they build their own software, develop their own software, that is similarly, we generate the metadata associated with the build process, that's signed, and that's also stored away. All those pieces go into a tamper-resistant ledger. What that allows us to do, when we deliver software to our customer, we're able to assemble a bundle that has not just the software bill of materials, but it also has the signatures for the environment in which the software was built, all of the build steps, each step along the way, and we can pull that data back out of the ledger. We can be confident that, you know, it wasn't tampered with along the way, that even if there is something inside our intranet that is malicious that we need to work around, we don't have an issue with the specific build that we're assembling for this specific customer. And then at the end of the day, that body of evidence is the term that we use, that helps us work with our customer to get an authorization to operate or to take that software into a classified environment. Now, when we take that software into a classified environment, we were traditionally faced with a challenge, right? Like I said, every piece of software we deliver has potentially thousands of individual components in it. We want to make sure that when we move something from an unclassified to a classified environment, or if you're not part of the government space, kind of think of moving it from an unregulated into a more regulated environment, we want to make sure that we understand exactly what we're moving across from one environment to the other. So we built an open source tool called Hopper. invite anybody to contribute to it. We think it's a great way to bundle together a set of dependencies or a set of software components, is because not only does it just pull together the tarball that you can then use to air gap, jump over the air gap, but it also includes that software bill of materials, includes all of that authenticated metadata, so we can be confident that the software we're moving into that regulated environment is exactly what we say it is and includes what we need. This is how this all comes together. I'll introduce this and then turn it over to Cole. So as you can see, we bring software in from the internet. It doesn't currently have signature data associated with it, so we use Witness to generate that data, store it in Arcavista. We then use that as part of our build pipeline. Witness is still there as part of our build pipeline to ensure that our own developed software is also being logged and tagged with metadata and signed and then submitted to Arcavista as well. And then as we go out to our release repositories, that's when we use Hopper to do the bundling so we can deliver it to a lab environment, test environment, or ultimately to our customer. I'll turn things over to Cole, who has, I think, a really cool demo for you.
So it goes on. I think so.
I think that'll work.
That works. Can y'all hear me? All right, good. So how many of y'all own a vehicle, right? Most of y'all probably own a vehicle. Oh, there we go. That works much better. So how many of y'all own a vehicle? Probably most of y'all, right? You know, and if there's something wrong with that vehicle, there's a component that malfunctions, right? You probably receive a recall notice telling you need to go fix that. Well, we can't do that in software right now, right? It's very, very difficult to do. We don't have the systems that we need to track all this data. So with Witness and Arcavista, that's what we're doing, right? Just like when a vehicle is manufactured, we collect metadata about each one of those steps. What goes into that vehicle? Who put that item into that vehicle? What company is responsible for that component, right? What firmware is in that component, right? We keep track of all this in a system. So when there's a problem with that, we can issue a recall notice to the owner of that vehicle. Well, with software, we need to do that as well, right? So what I'm going to show you today is a demo software factory with this build pipeline right here, and how we create those attestations within the GitLab environment, and then how we verify those attestations. So I'm going to stop the slide deck. And we're going to go over to our public GitLab instance. So if you want to, you can go and pull out your laptop and you can see what this repo is. It's 100% public. You go to testify sec demos software factory. So let's go ahead and dig into this pipeline. All right, great. So this is what you might put together if you want to create an SSDF compliant pipeline, right? We have our vault linting steps, we have our static analysis tests, we have our unit testing, go vet, we have a build process, and we build an image. Then we do a CVE scan on that image. We generate an SBOM based upon that image. We do a secret scan, and then we release it, right? So what's different is we have this step right here, and it's called verify. So we're gonna dig in a little bit, but each one of these steps, we're leveraging Witness to generate metadata about the inputs, the outputs, the process that was run, the transformation, right? The program identifier for, like if you're running Go or a CVE scan, right? What did that scan? As well as environment attributes, right? If you're running an AWS, it's kind of important for your customers to be able to tell that, hey, yeah, this build was happening in my secured AWS GovCloud. And I can prove that to you, right? It wasn't built by a malicious actor trying to perform a supply chain attack. All right, so let's go ahead and dig in. I'm going to bring up my code editor. Can you all see that? Do you need a little bit bigger back there? All right. So let's go ahead and look at... All right, so... So we're looking at GitLab CI YAML, right? If you've done anything with GitLab, you spent a lot of time in this file, so this would be pretty familiar to you. So you can see here we're using GitLab's new feature that allows us to sign things with SigStore. With Witness, though, it's actually got a plug-in system. So if you're using Vault, you want to use something like Spiffy Spire or a key from your disk, right? You're able to do that. And if you have something else that you use as a key provider, Witness is now a CNCF subproject of Intoto. So, hey, let us know, and we can work on that with you and make that happen. So you can see we're just running these make files right here and all here. So let's go dig down a little bit deeper and see what's in that make file, see how we're actually instrumenting this. Right, so you can see we define this witness run variable. Make it a little bit bigger, right? We have this witness run variable, and it has a bunch of flags. We have enable ArchiVista. So ArchiVista is a metadata store specifically designed for Intoto metadata. Intoto metadata is that glue, is that security metadata that allows us to validate supply chain. If you want to know more about Intoto, please stop by our booth over there, the open source booth. So, and then we define how we're signing it, right? We use FileSeal to request a certificate. So we have that data in there and all the parameters we need for that, right? And then we can see we're passing in our SIG store ID token, right? That's that token that's available within that GitLab environment. And because we need to go across an air gap, right? We need to be able to verify these artifacts when we don't have access to RecCore. So instead of doing a transparency log verification in this state, what we do is we countersign that signature with a timestamp. And this allows us to still have those same benefits of using a short-lived certificate that you would have with SigStore, but not having to have that online verification. That timestamp allows you to validate that, hey, this build process happened within that certificate validity period. So, and then we're going to generate some attestations, right? So we're actually going to store them here on our GitLab runner, as well as upload them to ArchiVista. Right, so, and then you can see, right, we have these different steps. So here's one of the steps right here, HADOLint, right? I just kind of want to show you that, right? That's kind of important. What we're doing there is we're just making sure that this Docker file that we have, there we go, right? You can see it's commented out there, so you might be able to predict what we're going to do in the future, right? We don't want our container running as root. So as one of the steps in our software supply chain, we make sure that, hey, you know, we're going to run HADL in it. It's not running as root, and we should be good to go. Okay, so let's go see what happens, right? And I'm going to skip actually running this pipeline right now because it might take a little bit of time. So please excuse me on that. But so you can see when we run that, we do the verify. We get everything. So what does this actually mean when we verify, right? Well, what it is we take all that evidence we generated about all these different steps and we put it into a controller where we evaluate it, right? What steps do we expect? What do the inputs and the outputs, how do they map to the other steps, right? So if I'm step number two, right, and step number one was pulling the software repository, all the files in step two should probably come from step one. If there's a mismatch in there, we probably have an issue with our supply chain, right? We should still have a red flag. So we're able to model the software supply chain based upon inputs and outputs, the data flow through the steps, as well as what we expect in each of the steps. So for example, with that HADOLint, right, we expect HADOLint to run. The materials from HADOLint should come from the same source as the commit. And then that should pass, right? All right, I'm going to go and dig into that policy and show you what that looks like. All right, so there we go, right? So we have this step, like this step name is format. We're going to require an attestation that gives us some values about the environment. We're going to have an attestation that gives us value about the Git repository. What's a commit hash, right? Who made this commit? If there's a signature on that, we're going to store that there. And then we take attestations about additional information about that environment. And then we want to make sure that, hey, this information, can we trust it? So we pin all this to what we call a functionary, right? And a functionary in this case is, hey, it's a certificate authority. So if you have a DoD RIT certificate, right, sign it with that sign it with your CAT card and we can put that on the policy. If you're using HashiCorp Vault to sign your things, right, you want to put the CA from Hashi Vault, your HashiCorp Vault instance in here as a functionary, right? If you're using SigStore like we are here, right, we'll actually have the SigStore root right here, right? So this is a Base64. I don't know if any of you can Base64 decode in your head, but if you can't, you just have to believe me. So this is the Sig server. This is the if you go and pull the certificate authority Sig server, this is what you get. And then we also want to pin it to that timestamp authority. Remember when I was talking about how we countersign that? So now this policy says all the things that should happen in the supply chain and how it should happen. All right, so let's go and actually see if this works, right? I hope it does. Oh, that is the wrong window. So I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to download. Okay, so I'm going to download the artifacts, right? And then this is going to go to my download directory. And so one of the artifacts I'm downloading is the tar of the image that we generated. So I'm going to run a witness verify on that tar. You can see it already passed here, but we're going to like simulate an air gap environment, right? We moved everything over to a different environment. We have no context of what the CI system does, right? We only have the evidence that the CI system generated. All right, so then we run a witness verify. So we pass in that policy, and this policy is actually signed, right? So if you have someone that's responsible for enforcing policy for your organization, right, they would sign this policy, and you must provide the public key for that when you do the verification. And then we pass in the dash F, you see the image.tar. And then what we're doing here is we're actually using Archivista. We don't want to be responsible for distributing all these attestations. So we use something called Archivista, which will build the graph and find all the attestations that might satisfy this policy, and then only evaluate to see if they actually do. All right, so let's see if this works. Cross your fingers. There we go. So verification succeeded. And now we can prove, cryptographically prove, that all those steps that we expected were followed. And then right here we have all the evidence, right? So not only have we proven it, but we're giving the evidence that we also proved it as well. And we're giving that back to you. So this is, we have this available not only in witness run, right, or witness verify, but it's also available in a admission controller, right? So you can move this policy enforcement all the way down to the endpoint. So you might be asking now, so what happens if a developer, you know, tries to get around this, right? So if they have access to that GitLab pipeline, they can change it, right? So let's go ahead and this Docker file, like I really need this to run this as root to get it to work. Like we really need to push this feature. I don't want to mess with like getting all my permissions right and everything like that. So I'm just going to run it as root. All right, so, and then I know that if I run this as root, that HATL step is going to throw an error, and I just need to get this through. So I'm going to go my GitLab YAML. No F, there you go. So this is a linting step right here, so I'm going to go... There we go. So let's just take this step out, right? We don't need that in there. All right. VS Code loves giving me pop-ups all the time. All right. All right, so we're pushing that. This should fail, right? Hopefully it fails. Oh, I messed up the YAML. Apologize for that.
you have a...
Well, I'm messing up the YAML.
You have a dependency.
Perfect. Yeah.
There it is right there.
Yeah. All right. I got some other issues going on. Let's do this a different, so what happens if you do that, right? And if I can get this YAML right, but running low on time. So if I get the YAML right, the attestation for that doesn't match what we expect. Because in that policy, and I'll actually show this. Right, so we have an expected command. Right, so we expect that command. So if the policy doesn't, if that command, when we do our command run a tester, we wrap the command that we're running, right? So we know what the system's trying to do. So we can record that evidence, and if that doesn't match what we expected it to, we can throw that up. So now what we've done is we've abstracted this policy away from the actual pipeline itself. So now if you're a CISO, if you generate attestations about every single one of your steps in your supply chain, now you can centralize that and see what supply chains are compliant and what ones aren't. And when we're talking about SSDF compliance, we're talking about that self-attestation form that I think has been in the news, right? Where organizations want you to attest to the security of your supply chain, right? We want to make sure we're providing the good information when we do that, right? And so generating this metadata is extremely important. And then validating that your supply chains meet the conformance is extremely important. So with that, do you have any questions or anything you want to see? Yeah. Yes. Right, so either, yeah, so when you do that, right, and you just run it as root, the HADL lint will fail, right? So because we measure the output from that step, we can tell it failed, and we expected it to pass, right? So then if you're a developer, right, that's going to, right, if you're using GitLab and you're not using this, right, that will stop the pipeline and you effectively stop that attack. But if your developer goes in and changes that, or there's a misconfiguration and that step doesn't happen, you're not, right? If you're relying on that person to do the right thing instead of making sure you have the correct process in place to make sure the things were followed, right? So developers are great, but we're busy and we push stuff when maybe we shouldn't because things need to get done, right? So if you have the supply chain policy in place, you're good to go. And you can at least protect the environments that are important to you. Right? We don't really care if a developer uses RIP in a permissive environment, right? Somewhere where they're allowed to dev, experiment, stuff like that. They shouldn't have to comply with supply chain policy so they can move fast, right? DevOps is about moving fast. DevSecOps is about moving fast and securely, right? So we need to have both of those. And this allows you to move the policy enforcement point to where it matters, right? If we're running a very high secure environment, like with Lockheed Martin, where they're running in classified environments, right? If we're putting software onto a weapon system, we might want to have a really, really tight policy where we're checking to make sure everything happens exactly where we want to. But let's say we're writing a web app that we're trying to give a demo for an organization, right? And it's just something that doesn't really matter that much. It doesn't matter if it's secure or not. Well, we can have a different supply chain policy for that development cluster, right? Because we don't need it locked down as much as a weapon system. So, there we go. All right, any other questions? All right, Hey, thank you all for joining. There is Witness and Archivista are now sub-projects of the Intota community. So if you want to know more about those, please visit the Intota booth over there. And then I'm the CEO of Testify SAC, and we're developing products around this and supporting and maintaining these projects. So if you're interested in that, please come visit our booth or talk to one of us here. Thank you.